Good morning, everyone, and welcome to New Life in the Bronx Church. I'm the lead servant, Pastor Robert Cole, and once again, as always, I am so thankful that you have decided to join us this morning as we worship and praise our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I would like to wish everyone a very Merry Christmas. I know I'm 2 days after Christmas, but it's still close enough that I wanted to say to you, Merry Christmas. I pray that each and every one of you had a wonderful time celebrating the birth of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and that you spent quality time with your loved ones and just really soaked up all that God has blessed you with. Amen. This is our last Sunday worship service of the year, and it has been a different year, but I am so thankful to God that He showed us the way. Amen. I was so thankful that when times became difficult, that we were able, as a congregation, and me personally as a believer, we were able to call out to the name of the Lord, knowing that He never leaves us nor forsakes us, and knowing that He was there. And hallelujah, the Lord did come through in a mighty, mighty big way. And so, Father God, we are so thankful to you for pulling us through the year 2020. And we believe that God is going to be with us in 2021 because He has not proven any other way. He's always been there for us. As long as we have come together and gathered under the name New Life in the Bronx Church, God has always been with us, and He has kept us in His perfect peace. Amen. And so we know, we are confident that the Lord will keep us through 2021. Amen. Praise God. So, like I said, this is our last service, Sunday service of the year 2020. But if you want to join us, if you want one more chance to fellowship and gather together, I want to invite you to come to our New Year's Eve celebration, which will be on Zoom. We will have the address at the end of this service on the list of announcements. So feel free to join us, whether you're a member of this congregation or not. Join us as we worship our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. This week there are no birthdays, but we can still celebrate the birth of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So come on, let's gather together, even through this media called Zoom, or not Zoom, YouTube. Let us gather together and worship in spirit and in truth. God bless you.
The passage I want to read before I pray is from Isaiah chapter 9. Especially for this Christmas season, it says, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulders, and his name shall be Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace." This Christmas, we celebrate many things that Jesus is to us. We know that we need him to hold the government on his shoulders, especially during this transition that's coming soon. We need his might and his strength to defeat COVID. We need his counsel, his care. But what I want to pray most for right now is for his peace. It says he is the Prince of Peace. And right now, over 320,000 lives have been lost to COVID. And on top of that, the statistic is that for every one death, 9 close family members have been impacted by that death. So we're talking about over 1 million people that are now being impacted by COVID through death. So I want to pray for God's peace. He's the Prince of Peace. And so let's pray for God's peace in our lives, especially in those who have lost loved ones, and especially in this season. Let's pray. Father, we celebrate many things that you are to us, and we celebrate most of all right now that you are the Prince of Peace, that even in our losses and our difficulties and challenges, Some of us have lost jobs this season. Some of us have lost work or even food or the ability to pay our rent. But most of all, some of us have lost people that we love. And so we pray for your comfort. We pray for your peace in this season, that you would help us to get through and that we could trust you to be the comfort and the strength we need this Christmas season, this New Year's, as we go through these holidays. I believe we need your comfort, your strength, and your peace most of all. We thank you in your Son's name. Amen.
When the Spirit of the Lord moves upon my heart, I will dance like David danced. When the Spirit of the Lord moves upon my heart, I will dance like David danced. I will dance, I will dance like David danced. I will dance, I will dance like David dance.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We glorify in your name, my God, because in you we have freedom to dance and worship and have fun. But Lord, we remember who you are, who you are. It says here in Philippians 2, in your relationship with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who being in the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made human in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. And we sing to the Ancient of Days, blessing and honor, glory and power be unto the Ancient of Days. Blessing and honor, glory and power be unto the Ancient of Days. From every nation, all of creation, bow before the Ancient of Days. Back to the top, blessing and honor. Blessing and honor, glory and power be unto the Ancient of Days. From every nation, all of creation, bow before the Ancient of Days. Every tongue in heaven and earth shall declare your glory. Shall bow at your throne. In worship you will be exalted, O God, and your kingdom shall not pass away, O Ancient of Days. Your kingdom shall reign over all the earth. Sing unto the Ancient of away, O Ancient of Days. declare your glory. Every knee shall bow at your throne. In worship you will be exalted, O God, and your kingdom will not pass away, O Ancient of Days, O Ancient of Days, O Ancient. Blessing and honor, glory and power be unto you, O Ancient of Days. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's just take a moment and breathe in. Holy Spirit, thank you, Lord, that you are here with us, that you inhabit our praises. Your name is beautiful. Your name is wonderful. Your name is powerful. That's the God I serve. That's the God I worship. You were the Word at the beginning, one with God the Lord Most High. You hid in glory in creation. Now revealed in you are Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name. Death could not hold you. The veil tore.
Hallelujah. Praise God. I would like to thank Reverend Orlando and Sister Maritza for that wonderful time of praise. Hallelujah. Thank you for leading us into that time and through that time of praise. Sister Maritza, I like the way you were getting strumming that guitar. It seems to me like you're getting a lot more comfortable in front of this camera. It does take some time, but I'm glad to see it, and we are all benefiting from that time of worship, just really participating in what God has you leading us to do. So please keep up the good work. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You know, as we celebrate the Christmas season, the Christian church reminds itself of that God's loving gift of salvation came down to earth as Christ came to seek and save the lost. No longer will we have to live isolated from God, controlled by our sinful desires and ways. For the believer, Christmas is about the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ. It's about God intervening to bring change to everyone that will believe in the story of the virgin birth, that will believe in the power of eternal life that comes through Jesus Christ, who believe that Jesus died for our sin on the cross, and who will believe in the one who was raised from the dead for the forgiveness of our sins, and who will accept Jesus Christ so that they can begin to immediately live the new life by the power of God's Holy Spirit. Amen. Hallelujah. Christmas is when we retell the story of the birth that will bring new life to everyone. You know, I used to say, same story again? Tell the same story again? Well, that's what this time is about. That's what you do when you remember. You tell the same story over and over so that we would never, ever forget just how wonderful God has been to us. So that we would never forget how marvelous this gift of salvation that comes through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ really is. So that we will remember on those days when we're feeling down and maybe feeling defeated, that we would remember that there's victory in the name of Jesus Christ and no other name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, the baby Jesus was a symbol of new life for the child. And it was also a symbol of new life for everyone. And so I'd like you to come with me and let us take time to retell the Apostle John's account of this wonderful story of Christ's birth, as we allow God to remind us of the power we receive to change both our lives as well as those around us. Today I want to entitle the sermon, The Birth That Brings New Life to Everyone. Once again, The Birth That Brings New Life to Everyone. Hallelujah. Because this gift of salvation is for everyone. Amen? For everyone, Jews as well as Gentiles, as the Bible tells us in Romans. Unfortunately, and this is very sad for me, unfortunately, not everyone takes advantage of it. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. New. The old things have passed away. Behold, all things, not some things, not many things, not most things, but all things have become new. Hallelujah. If you're ready for a change in your life, stick around. if you want to be reminded of the change that has occurred in your life when you accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I want to encourage you to stick around because God has a story for us to hear. So once again, as we're speaking on the topic, the birth that brings new life to everyone. And so today we're going to read from John chapter 1, beginning with verse 1. So as we usually do, let's ask God, amen? Let's ask God in the name of Jesus to lead us in this time of study so that we'll learn more about him and learn more about how we should and can live in our relationship with him, amen? So would you join me for this time of prayer? Father God, in the name of Jesus, we come to you because you are the way, the truth, and the life. Father, you have created all things, and you have given your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, who has given us the Holy Spirit to bring to our remembrance the things that you have taught us. And so, Father, we ask now, in the name of Jesus, by the power of your Holy Spirit, to speak to us now. Teach us, help us where we don't understand. Help us in our weakness, O Lord God, so that we may walk strongly with you and bring glory to your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. So once again, I would like to ask you to open your Bibles to John chapter 1, starting with verse 1. Hallelujah. 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 And the Bible, the Word of God, rather, reads like this. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Amen. He was with God. He, being the Word, was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. Amen. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm jumping down right now to verse 9. All right, so skip down to verse 9. The true light that gives light to everyone, amen, everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet, to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human desire or decision, or a husband's will, but born of God. Verse 14, the Word that we were talking about earlier, the Word became flesh and made his dwelling amongst us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. Skipping down to verse 18, if you would, please. Verse 18 says, no one has ever seen God, but the one and only Son, who is himself God and is in closest relationship with the Father, has made him known. Amen. Praise the Lord for his word. Praise God. Praise God. There's a lot of meat in those texts. And with the help of the Lord, we are going to get through it today together. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So take out your pens, take your notes. Hallelujah. Keep your word open as we ask God to speak to us now in Jesus' name. Our scripture today takes us back to the beginning of time, the place where God intervened and created the world with his spoken word. And you can find that in Genesis chapter 1, verses 1 to 3. This is the beginning of time as we, as humans, know it. It is the introduction of God as our creator, having created the world and mankind. This is important in our story because today some people acknowledge the creator but do not know that the creator, they don't know the creator as the word or as Jesus Christ. For all who do not know, look at John chapter 1 verse 3 where it says the word. Jesus Christ created all things, and all things were created by him. Hallelujah. And so I want them to know that Jesus is the creator. The creator has a name. You don't have to call him creator. You can call him Jesus. You can call on his name. You can accept his name. And hallelujah, the same one who created, the same one who saves, will save you, hallelujah, his creation for God's glory. Amen, hallelujah. The Christmas story, as it has been deemed by Christians, teaches that the birth was about bringing Jesus into the world, not about him being personally created or the beginning of his existence. For the Bible teaches that Jesus existed at what we know as the beginning of time. He didn't start where our time started, and he definitely did not start with the birth of the baby in the manger. His coming into the world is about God's plan for redemption. It is about God's desire to restore mankind's relationship with him. It's about the birth that brings new life to everyone. This is the reason we celebrate Jesus' birth. I want to highlight in John's account of this miracle event that the Word, which is later identified as Jesus in John chapter 1, verse 14, was with God, but more importantly, was God. Amen? Or just as importantly, was God. You see, as I just stated, the birth of the child that was born to the virgin by the power of the Holy Spirit was about God's restorative plan for his creation. Amen. It wasn't about the coming of Jesus Christ, but it was about the coming of Jesus Christ into the world. Here's why the scripture The word also tells us that Jesus was with God, and just as importantly, that Jesus was God. We can't miss that. That the Word was God, and that the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we beheld his glory as the only Son of the only begotten Son of the Father, full of grace and truth. Amen. The Word was with God, and the Word, Jesus Christ, was God. This is why the scripture says in Matthew chapter 1, verse 23, that the child will be called Emmanuel, which means God is with us. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Because when the birth of the child, the baby Jesus, is God with us. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm talking to you today about a glorious event. A glorious event. The coming of our Lord and Savior, God intervening in a sinful world to bring about positive change. Hallelujah. Philippians 2:6 says, who, speaking about Jesus, who, being in very nature God, right? Or who, being God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. Christ was not just any child, hallelujah, born on that Christmas night. He was special. He was, as Hebrews 1:3 tells us, the exact representation of God's being. Come in the flesh. Amen? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Philippians reminds us that he, Christ, humbled himself. His birth also reminds us. His birth in a manger also reminds us that Christ humbled himself. These experiences illustrate that God's commitment was not having people praise his name at that moment, but God's commitment was to his plan for salvation. Amen. God did not come with all the pomp and circumstance. He came humbly because he wanted the attention on his plan for salvation. That Jesus Christ has humbled himself and come to earth to intervene in the chaos that's being caused by sin, so that we may live freely from sin and live a life that glorifies God. Amen. Hallelujah. That we would even follow the example of Jesus Christ, who humbled himself, and that we would humble ourselves so that others would be saved. Hallelujah. So that others would hear the gospel message, that others would see the love of God as God works through us by the power of the Holy Spirit. These experiences illustrate that God's commitment, that his commitment was to his plan for salvation. His birth, just like his death on the cross, both humbling experiences, was to place our focus on God's faithfulness to change lives by justifying his sinful people and bringing them to a state of righteousness. Amen? And that's why today we're speaking about the birth that brings new life to everyone. As we go to verse 4 and 5, these verses point out how this gift, Jesus, brought life. That was also described as light to all mankind, not some. He brought it to everyone. And I think that we would do well to remember that Jesus brought the gift, the light, the life to everyone. Hallelujah. That could be that he brought life that was also described as light to all mankind. That could not be his light, rather. Let me say it like this. His light. The light of Jesus Christ could not be overcome by darkness and the sinfulness of an evil world. Hallelujah. With this point, Christmas reminds us that there is a need for salvation. There is a need for light. Because darkness, which represents sin, darkness seeks to separate us from God and His love. Darkness and evil seek to isolate us. So we fall prey to our own sinful desires and reject God. All right? That is His plan. That's the plan of the enemy, to isolate us and to get us to not call on that mighty name of Jesus. You know, have you ever noticed that when you're not feeling strong and that things are, and you're not feeling good about yourself, that you tend to gravitate away from people and you tend to find yourself alone? And it is when you are alone and isolated from people and at times trying to isolate yourself from God that we begin to understand that we don't have the strength. We don't have the natural strength to fight the challenges that tempt you. That's why it is then that Satan is most happy, as well as most dangerous. Because there is no one, when you're isolated and by yourself, and Satan is bombarding you with temptation after temptation after temptation, you don't feel good about yourself. You may even question whether the Lord is around. It's then that he reminds you, or rather, that Satan, during this dangerous time, tries to remind you that God is not with you. He showers you with darkness. Have you ever noticed that when you're feeling sad, we call it depression, you go into what? Darkness. You isolate yourself. But the fact that the light has come into this world, the light that brings life, the light that is Jesus Christ has come into this world and darkness has not been able to put it out, reminds us of how good God is. Hallelujah. You see, Christmas reminds us that even though there is darkness, the light has come. Hallelujah. The Word became flesh. The light has come. And the darkness has not been able to overcome it, has not been able to put it out. John reminds us that Christ is the light of the world. And John's account of the birth of Christ reminds us that this light will come into the midst of darkness. I want to tell you today, regardless of how dark your situation may be, and I'm not saying it's not dark. I'm not trying to judge how dark it is, but I'm telling you today, in the name of Jesus, that John's gospel reminds us of the birth of Jesus Christ, and John's gospel reminds us, no matter how dark your situation is, the light comes. Hallelujah. The light came. Although there was darkness, the light still came into the world. Hallelujah. Christ coming into the world, God intervening in our world, reminds us that the light comes regardless of how dark our situation. The light will come into the darkness of any situation. And the gospel reminds us that Christ will never leave us nor forsake us. Amen. Hallelujah. That's a promise to you. I'm going to put it in the second person, that Christ never leaves you nor forsakes you. I want to put it in the first person, that Christ will not leave me. And he will not forsake me, no matter how dark the situation is. And you can find that in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5. Even during your darkest periods, you can call on the name of Jesus, the gift that was given to you on Christmas morning, to come and change your situation. Hallelujah. Isn't that good news? Isn't that good news? Isn't that worth celebrating? Hallelujah. You can do it with the confidence that the darkness cannot overcome Christ, but that Christ has already, hallelujah, Christ has already overcome the darkness. We no longer need to isolate ourselves, hallelujah. We no longer need to stay home, avoiding God or his people. Because we know that the light has come. We know that the light, that the darkness cannot put out the light. And so we know that we are victorious in Jesus Christ. Verse 9 tells us that the true light that gives life to everyone was coming into the world. And although he was already in the world, and the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. Hallelujah. However, the word of God tells us that those that did recognize him as Savior would experience the change in their lives, the change in their positions, and that they would become a child of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And God does not, let me tell you right now, hallelujah, God does not leave his children behind. God does not forsake his children. Amen. God, as the birth of Jesus Christ shows, God keeps his promise. Hallelujah. Children born of God, that's what we would become. Children born of God by the power of God's Holy Spirit and not by the husband's will. We would be adopted, as Paul reminds us in Romans, that we would be adopted into the family of God, able to live by the power of the Holy Spirit. That we would no longer have to walk in darkness, because we could walk in the light that brings us into a right relationship with God. Hallelujah. You ever be in a dark situation, a dark room where you hear strange sounds and you might even feel something run across your feet? When we were younger, we used to go to the Prospect. Now, I'm not that old when the Prospect was grand. I know the Prospect in the late 70s, early 80s, when things used to run across your feet. And if they didn't run across your feet, you thought they ran across your feet. And where your feet used to stick onto the floor because of all the candy that had been dropped and not cleaned up. We couldn't wait. We couldn't wait. I recall going to that movie theater to watch Willard. That was a movie about rats. That was the worst thing I could have done, was to go into a theater where my feet were sticking on the floor, where it felt like things were running up and down across my feet, eating the popcorn that was being dropped, and watching a movie about rats, hundreds and thousands of rats. That was the worst thing. I could not wait until the light turned on and I can look at what was actually taking place by my feet. I couldn't wait to get out of there. Light came into darkness. That's how it is for so many of us. We are being tormented in the darkness. And that we can't wait for some light to come. And God is telling us now, the birth of Jesus Christ, the light of the world, has come. Hallelujah. God has shined his light so that we no longer have to live in darkness. We no longer have to stay tormented by the things running up and down across our feet. We don't need to be tormented by the sin of this world. But we, hallelujah, hallelujah, can use the light to guide us to a better place. And the light will bring us into a right relationship, the word of God tells us, a right relationship with God. Prior to this gift of salvation, that is Jesus Christ, sin forced us to reject God and to reject his grace. But as children of God, we are no longer God's enemies. We are reconciled by the life and death and resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. So having been reconciled, how much more, the Bible says, shall we live by his life? Amen. How much more? Hallelujah. We have been granted, as children, we are granted freedom to choose God and live by the power of his Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. As we surrender more and more of our desires to God, more of his Holy Spirit will fill us and will empower us to live differently. Are you getting the understanding of why this gift of Jesus Christ is so important? But it was when we accept the gift of Jesus Christ, we receive all God's other blessings. We receive the power of his Holy Spirit that Jesus sent to help us. And that the power of his Holy Spirit is able to keep us in righteousness until Christ's return. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. We, by the power of the Holy Spirit, will be able to live differently and bring glory to God's name and make a better life for those who we come into contact with. As Christians, when we relate to others, we are called to bring the personal changes that we have experienced into our relationship with others. You know, I have a friend, and our friendship is developing. And as all friendships go, you know, you walk with people, and you watch, you observe, you listen, and based on what you hear and which way the friendship's going, it either develops into a deeper friendship or begins to fizzle and becomes an association. Amen. But I have a friend that helps me set up and purchase the equipment that I need to be able to conduct these services online. And we recently, the church is in need of new equipment. Okay. And so he agreed to come along with me and to go and to look at some equipment. And we ran across a piece of used mixer, and it was about a $2,000 mixer. They were selling it for $1,200, but the price tag on it was $449. And you know my old Edenwald project self said, well, let me see how much this really costs. So I asked the guy, how much does it cost? I would have took whatever he said. He said, $449. I was like, oh, boy. And I looked at my friend's face, and he kind of like looked down, and you know, I couldn't read what he was thinking, but he looked down, and when that didn't end up being the price, by the way, but and had it been, I don't know what I would have done, to be honest with you. But he looked at me and he said, "I'm very uncomfortable." And I was like, "Yeah, why?" And he said, Because that's not, he basically said, that's not what God has called us to do. That's not how he has called us to live. And I was so happy that he said that. I mean, the flesh in me wanted to try to see if I could get over and pay $400 for a $2,000 mixer. But that would not have pleased God, and that bothered me. But I was so glad that he said something. And that told me that he was a true friend. That he was a true friend, that he would continue to look out. And that's the type of friendships we need to be engaged in. We need to be engaged in friendships with people who speak to us honestly, particularly about the Word of God. And you know what happened? I said, well, that's something I struggle with. And he agreed that that was something that he had struggled with. And wouldn't you know, the next day when we went to pick up and pay for the equipment, there were three speakers on the cart instead of two. Hallelujah. I was so glad he said something, because the Holy Spirit didn't need to convict me at that point. I immediately said, sir, there's three speakers on here. They're only supposed to be two. I didn't even want to give it a chance. I didn't want to give the devil a chance to even begin to tempt me. Hallelujah. I said, we're only paying for two, not three. You see, this is the type of relationships that God wants us in. This is why, as we become strong in the Holy Spirit, and as the Holy Spirit moves more and more in our lives, hallelujah, God will challenge those areas of our weakness, because he knows the Holy Spirit, and he knows the Holy Spirit can pull us through. I have a newfound respect for my friend. I trust him more today than I did a couple of days ago. Not that he's ever done anything against me, but on that day, he would speak up and speak the things of God so that I would not stumble in my darkness. He would shine light into my dark areas. I want to tell you today, saints, the light has come in the world. Do not be afraid to allow the light that is Jesus Christ, that gives us the gift of eternal life. Do not be afraid to allow that gift, that light, to be shined in the dark areas of your life. You should expect those who are in the light to shine the light of God, the light that God has given to them, in your dark areas. If we all were able to be in more and more relationships like that, then we would, by the power of the Holy Spirit, live better lives. You know, a lot of people would say, I don't want to be around that guy. He did not judge me. He told me how uncomfortable he was. And by doing that, he shined light on a dark area, thus saving me from walking in darkness. It's easy to get lost in darkness. But when the light of God is shined, it's not so easy to get lost. It's a clear path. We need clear paths. This birth brings new life to everyone. The birth of Jesus Christ brings light to everyone so that we can all see the way that we should go. Amen. Amen. This is the power of the gift of God, the birth that brings new life to everyone. The new life we receive from Christ should bring positive change in our lives as well as in the lives of others. Amen. You, me, all who believe in Jesus Christ, all who have the light of God shining in us, shining through us, should be a light in all situations and speak up and advocate for what is right and not what is wrong. Amen. Hallelujah. We are advocating for what is right. We are allowing the light of God to shine through us. We are not judging. We are not condemning. We are allowing God's light to shine so that others may repent and change and be saved. Hallelujah. Even if just saved from that situation like I was. I don't know what I would have done if the man would have held to the $449 price. But because my friend was with me, and my friend is a believer in Jesus Christ, and my friend allowed the light of Christ to shine, because of that, I know I would have said, that's not the right price. Amen. Hallelujah. But on my own, I don't know what I would have done. And we need to be honest with ourselves. We need to be honest with the things that challenge us so that God can work with us. We need to allow the light to convict us. Convict us, right? Yeah, convict us, not condemn us. We need to let the light convict us so that we, hallelujah, will walk in the light and get out of the darkness. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Don't worry about the darkness. The Bible says the darkness cannot overcome the light. We already have victory. So with that said, let me speak honestly to you right now. These are wonderful blessings that we're talking about. These are wonderful blessings that we receive from the gift that comes from God. And it is true that the gift of salvation is for everyone. However, you cannot fully benefit from the blessings of God if you have not accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Now, I don't want to say that. I don't want to scream. I don't want to holler at people. But it doesn't make it any less the truth. We must accept Jesus Christ. You must be saved in order to receive God's Holy Spirit and the fullness of it, the fullness of God's Holy Spirit. You must accept Jesus Christ. You must surrender more and more of yourself to God so that His Holy Spirit would fill us. Amen? And lead us and direct us. That's what it means to walk in the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. God's blessings come if you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. The gift is a gift of salvation. And the gift tells us that the word of God tells us that there is no other name in heaven or on earth by which we must be saved but the name of Jesus Christ. Christ is the gift that requires a response. You cannot allow Christ just to stay in the corner like a trophy. Like all other gifts that you need to use, you must accept the gift. And you must use it in order to experience the change that God has planned for you. Let's move on to verse 14. The Word, the Bible says, became flesh on that Christmas day to dwell among us, to live among us. The Word is Jesus Christ. And the Bible says we have seen His glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father full of grace and truth. Christ coming in the flesh ensures that we obtain an understanding of God and His glory. No longer are we walking in the dark when it comes to the things of God, because God intervened and sent His one and only Son. The Bible states that Jesus came to earth full of God's grace, as well as His truth. Amen? This combination is so important. He came full of grace and truth. And the reason why this combination is so important, because the holiness of God's truth has proven too much for us to follow. too much for us to follow, especially to follow perfectly. But Christ's grace, his love, and his forgiveness enables us to be deemed righteous and able to have our relationship with God restored. Amen. Jesus came full of grace and truth. The truth will always be there. The truth will set us free. But just like in the movie, I can't remember the name right now, just like in the movie where the army officer said, where one army officer who was a lawyer said, we want the truth. And the other officer answered, you can't handle the truth. Well, we want the truth of God. But truth without grace will overwhelm us. Truth without grace will require that we fall short. That's why the Bible says, for all have fallen short of God's glory. But all are justified freely by the grace that comes to Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Once again, I'm speaking about the birth that brings new life. The birth of Christ. The one who knew no sin, yet took upon himself the sin of the world, ensures his coming, ensures that Christ understands each and every one of us. He understands all, not some, but all that we can possibly go through. So if you believe you have a situation that Christ cannot understand, I want to tell you today that you're sadly mistaken. The one who came and took upon the sin of the world, upon his shoulders, came so that he would understand everything that you could possibly go through. He would understand, and that he would be able to shine his light so that he would bring us the victory we need to overcome the sin of this world. Not even physical death can separate us from the love of God and from his gift of salvation. When we accept Jesus Christ, we receive the gift of salvation, eternal life. When we accept it, when we accept Christ as our Lord and Savior, we receive eternal life. And that's a mighty, mighty long time. Today's scripture reminds us that the birth we celebrate each Christmas day was not just any birth, but it was a wonderful event that changed our lives, giving us new life and giving new life to everyone who believes. I want to ask you right now, before I leave, before I end today, I want to ask you, have you accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? If not, I would like to ask you, would you like to take hold of the gift that God has given to you? You can do so by accepting Jesus Christ, by saying what's called the sinner's prayer, the prayer of salvation. God will hear you. He has come. And right now, the Lord Jesus sits at the right hand of God interceding on our behalf. He wants to intercede for you. Would you say this prayer and accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? And if you have already accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, then I ask you today to continue following him, continue calling on his name. And I ask you to pray, asking God to continue to fill you with his Holy Spirit and to shine his light in your darkest places so that you would not lose your way, but that you would continue on the path of righteousness. But let me take this time right now to pray for those who want to accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. Please pray with me. Repeat after me. Father God, I come in the name of Jesus Christ. I have heard his story. And by your grace, I believe. I believe that he can help me. And by his grace, I can be made whole. And so, I confess with my mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord. And I believe in my heart that God raised him from the dead. And that by accepting Jesus Christ today, through this prayer, by his blood I am washed clean. I no longer have the stains of sin on my body. I am a new creature, ready to live a new life in Jesus' name. And so, Father, come into my life. Save me, sanctify me, heal me, and give me the expectation of your soon return. I ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you and God keep you. What a wonderful story we just went through. Jesus, the new birth that gives and brings new life to everyone. Everyone who believes. God bless you and may you have a prosperous 2021 in Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. God bless you.